We are here to discuss the income gap, public interest, and the economy. And I'm very excited, as I know you are, to hear Rani Farha speak. And I know she's going to have some great provocative insights for us. And I've been asked to provide some opening remarks, which, speaking about human rights, to open up for a person like Leilani, it feels a bit like playing shinny with Wayne Gretzky. And, I'll do my best, hopefully provide some thoughts that might get our creative juices going here. To begin, I think it's quite fitting that we're having this conversation today, because as many of you may or may not know, today, February 20th, happens to be the United Nations World Day of Social Justice. So in honor of this day, I'd like to begin our evening together by reading part of Secretary General Ban Ki-moon's message for World Social Justice Day 2013. He says, "As we mark World Day of Social Justice, we see far too many places where there are increasing opportunities for a few and only rising inequality for the many. Growing inequality undermines the international community's progress in lifting millions out of poverty and building a more just world. The fault lines are visible in falling wages for women and young people and limited access to education, health services, and decent jobs. We must strengthen and build institutions and develop policies that promote inclusive development. As we seek to build the world we want, let us intensify our efforts to achieve a more inclusive, equitable, and sustainable development path built on dialogue, transparency, and social justice." Having a dialogue about building the world we want. I think that's what we're all here to do together this evening. So I think it's quite appropriate that we're here on this day. What is the world we want? As a way to begin that conversation, I'd like to pose a basic question. And that's, who am I? Not who am I, but ask yourself, who am I? We all have multiple identities. And if I was to answer that, I don't know what would come first. I'm many things. Somebody standing up here again who gets to speak to you tonight. I'm a father. I'm a worker, a citizen. It seems to me, though, that in our public life, we have perhaps three identities that I've noticed. And I wanted to speak a little bit about those three identities as a way of introducing the work of the Poverty Reduction Initiative, which I won't talk a lot about, but I want to give you some things to think about and perhaps help you see the way that we've approached poverty in our work. And then we'll get to the idea of granola bar justice somewhere here. But the first identity was actually the first one that was mentioned. We're citizens. So that's really what usually is our primary, you might think of it as a primary identity, as citizens, as Canadians, as Albertans, as Calgarians. It denotes ideas of rights and responsibilities. And it defines who we are, not only by where we live, but also by the community that we've chosen to attach ourselves to. I'd suggest, though, as I've observed, even over my not that long lifetime, that we've assumed a second public identity, which I think is very important. And that identity is consumer. And this now seems to be almost as important as our identity as citizens. Our social and economic health seems to be almost dependent on our ability and desire to consume. We hear daily concerns about consumer confidence. We engage in retail therapy. And somehow, shopping has become not only a recreational activity, but almost a cultural or moral good or even obligation. Because if we're not consuming, the economy is not growing, right? And then where are we? But I think there's even a third public identity that we've adopted, and that is taxpayer. We have a Canadian Taxpayers Federation, and it frequently, along with many of the rest of us, expresses outrage about government excesses using our tax money as an affront not to citizens, but as an affront to taxpayers. The government of Canada, I was interested to learn, actually has a taxpayers ombudsman and a taxpayers bill of rights. I didn't know that. So this got me interested. I went online, I went on to Google, and I quickly did a search of the words taxpayer, consumer, and citizen. And what I found was that in the Calgary Herald website, there were 2,400 references to consumers, 570 references to taxpayers, and only 300 references to citizens. Remarkably, even the Government of Canada website, when I went on there and did a search, it has 94,000 references to consumers and only 24,000 to citizens. So clearly the way we see ourselves and the way we talk about ourselves as a society has shifted from being citizens to being consumers to being taxpayers. Now some people would ask, does it matter? And I think what we call ourselves matters a great deal because it defines how we relate to each other. As citizens, we relate to each other as equal members of a community with both rights and responsibilities. Citizenship is inclusive. It involves everybody. Children, seniors, workers, students, able, disabled, it doesn't matter. Your membership in community isn't defined by those kinds of labels or parameters. It exists by virtue of the bonds of community that we share with each other, which is very different from consumer relationships. Consumer relationships are not inclusive at all, because they only exist when you're part of the market, when you're out in the market for the purpose of buying and selling goods and services. Consumer relationships are about power. The more money you have, the more power you have. If you're not in the market, you have no power at all, and you can't even be part of the relationship. Now, if we think of ourselves as taxpayers, this actually is an interesting new variation of our identity as consumers. Because as we shift from being consumers, from being citizens to consumers to taxpayers, our relationship with society and each other changes. As taxpayers, our relationship with society and with each other becomes a consumer relationship. We pay taxes to receive services, kind of like we're buying a television or groceries or a new car. And like consumer relationships, if you don't pay, you're not really part of the picture. So could it be that over time, our rights and responsibilities to each other have turned into a giant marketplace where we see each other primarily as purchasers of government services? We demand value for money. We demand to know how our tax dollars are being spent. We demand to see the individual benefit of the taxes we pay. So we begin to question, why should I pay education taxes when I don't have children? And like good hagglers in the marketplace, we have all sorts of strategies to haggle the price of our services down. We call it tax avoidance. So this isn't to say anything about whether taxes are good or bad, or whether they're being spent wisely or not. We all have our own opinions on that. But it does say something about our identity as people, when our role as taxpayers defines who we are rather than our role as citizens. Because we come to relate to each other primarily through money, as opposed to being members of a community with inherent rights and responsibilities. So I also think that this has a great deal to do with inequality. If you remember during the recent U.S. election, presidential candidate Mitt Romney infamously divided the country into givers and takers. And I think the consumer and taxpayer language makes that division possible. And we're very good at dividing ourselves up. We talk about the poor as if they're a separate species. And once we do that, it's easy to see people as other than ourselves. And that allows us to assign blame and deny rights. It becomes easy to see poverty as a competition between the poor and the non-poor, between us, the taxpayers, and them, the tax takers. And even among the poor, we distinguish between the deserving poor and the undeserving poor. So it might be easy to show charity to a person who's developed a disability and can't work, but what about to a person with an addiction? Charity is important, but the challenge with charity is that it reinforces those power relationships that we have. It gives me the power to choose who's deserving and who's undeserving. And as our services for the poor are increasingly delivered by social agencies, it turns those relationships into monetary transactions. Rather than entering into a relationship with someone, I can instead spend my charitable dollars at an agency, and if I give wisely, I get a tax receipt. Several years ago, I was approached by a woman on the street. She asked me for some money. I didn't know what she needed it for, and in many respects, it's not my right to know. I gave her some and expected that would be the end of it, and thought I would just walk on. And then a funny thing happened. She took out a granola bar, and she insisted that I had it. I refused because obviously she needs the money, not me. And how can I take her granola bar? She insisted, so I took it. Why did I take a granola bar from the street person? Because when I took the granola bar, something extraordinary happened. She changed in both our eyes. Now she was suddenly the giver, and I was the taker. My act of charity was now met with a reciprocal act that for one moment equalized the power between us. And it restored to her, for a little brief moment in time, a measure of dignity. I still have the granola bar, I keep it on my desk as a reminder. I think many of you here are perhaps charitable givers, which is great, but I'd like to challenge your giving. First, I'd like to challenge you to give not just to the deserving, but also to those who you might consider to be undeserving. Or further, don't just give to those who need, but also give to those who don't. For don't we all in some way need, and aren't we all deserving? Isn't that the foundation of justice and citizenship? Uncoupling giving from need may be the first important step in moving from charity to justice. And so too when we receive, if we uncouple giving from receipt, giving from need, maybe we can uncouple receiving from need as well, allowing ourselves to be recipients of the gifts of others. And we all like to give because that gives us the power. We hold the power when we give. But when we receive, we allow ourselves to be vulnerable, and this breaks that power down. Humbly receiving the gifts of others requires trust because we need to become vulnerable ourselves. And it's this reciprocity that might allow us to redefine ourselves again as citizens rather than as consumers or taxpayers. In our work with the Poverty Reduction Initiative, we've deliberately not spoken about poverty lines, and in fact, we've hesitated to speak about poverty itself. We try not to think about the poor or the non-poor, because when we make those convenient distinctions into the poor and non-poor, it immediately sets up an us and them conversation, which is at worst conflictual, and at best simply leads us into charity rather than justice. And it also belies the fact that we're all vulnerable. If we address that vulnerability by working together as citizens and members of community rather than as consumers, taxpayers, and charitable givers, perhaps we can reclaim the idea of the public good and move towards a just society where we all deserve. Then we'll have built a city that works for all of us. And I propose we'll have also done something about poverty too. Almost by accident. I'm greatly looking forward to our conversation this evening. Thank you for your attention and your willingness to engage in it with us. Thank you to the Sheldon Toomer Foundation for graciously hosting this dialogue. And especially thank you to Leilani for coming to spend the evening with us here in Calgary. And I know we'll all be enriched by your insights.